afternoon. My name is Ashley Chan, and I am an executive ally serving at New Voices Pittsburgh. Today I'm going to be presenting What the Frack? Environmental Stewardship Meets Reproductive Justice, A Love Story and a Riddle. Current environmental initiatives and research do not necessarily impact low-income or communities of color sustainably or subjectively. For example, the weatherization of homes are chiefly incentivized as financial savings to homeowners when it comes to annual utility costs or resale value. Glossing over some of the more technical and distant environmental benefits, such as reducing greenhouse gas emissions. Resources about the technical and financial costs of upkeep also aren't always included with in-kind service, provided affordably or facilitated by local professionals of color or the homeowners themselves. It's not really sustainable on a larger scale or imbuing of healthy environmental habits and awareness in everyday people. Also, not everyone is a homeowner. Some folks are on public housing or live in assisted living facilities, while many others rent in Pittsburgh. The lottery of who actually benefits from weatherization programs or other green initiatives long-term often marginalizes communities and families who are the most vulnerable, low income, of color, undocumented, college-aged, and so on and so forth. To be truly practical, equitable, and sustainable to all folks across barriers and experiences, environmental stewardship needs to include the foundation of intersectionality. It needs to recognize the many diverse parts of identity that enrich one's life and experiences, as well as address and challenge oppression and marginalization. This year, at my placement of New Voices Pittsburgh, I was introduced to reproductive justice, a social change movement led by women of color. A theory of reproductive justice freedom for all people, and an everyday way of life that affirms the multiplicity of one's identity. The basic tenets of reproductive justice are the right to have children, the right to not have children, and if fortunate, the right to parent these children in safe and healthy environments. Reproductive justice requires that the decision of whether or not we have children or choose to raise children remain unaffected by inequitable distributions of environmental burdens. In the simplest example, everyday folks are exposed to environmental toxins in the personal care products they use throughout their homes. Manufacturers are not required to regulate or disclose all the ingredients or chemicals used in or released by air fresheners, household cleaners, lotions, and other consumer products, including deodorant, makeup, and food and drink items. In a 2011 study led by the University of Washington, the air vented from laundry machines was studied to look at the ingredients of a top-selling scented liquid laundry detergent and dryer sheet. It was determined that the fragrance laundry products contained more than 25 VOCs, including 7 known hazardous air pollutants. 2 chemicals found in the products are specifically classified by the EPA as carcinogens and do not have established safe exposure levels. These products can affect not only personal health, but also public and environmental health. The chemicals can go into the air, down the drain, into water bodies, where fish and other aquatic critters live, where we get our municipal drinking water from, and where we go to play recreationally. Acetaldehyde is found throughout the environment as well as formed in the body from the breakdown of ethanol, mostly introduced through the consumption of alcoholic beverages. However, symptoms of chronic or long-term intoxication resemble those of alcoholism. It is also considered a probable human carcinogen and has the cancer classification of a group B2. Animal studies have shown nasal tumors in rats and laryngeal tumors in hamsters. Many individuals are exposed to acetaldehyde simply by breathing. According to the EPA, residential fireplaces and wood stoves are the 2 highest sources of emissions, followed by industrial sources. In the Seattle area alone, where the study was conducted, researchers estimated the annual emissions of acetaldehyde due to the use of only the single laundry detergent and compared it to the annual acetaldehyde emissions caused by cars. The chemical emissions of the laundry detergent was found to be about 3% of that of cars. That doesn't sound too bad now, does it? What's 3%? But what if I told you the annual emissions of cars in Seattle would be approximately 56,000 pounds per year? 3% from this one top-selling laundry detergent equals about 1,660 pounds per year. Assuming similar results, the researchers went on to estimate the potential emissions from the top 5 brands of laundry detergent. The estimate doubled to be about 6%, or 3,545 pounds. So let's do this math real quick. In Seattle, from cars and the 5 top-selling laundry detergent brands alone, 59,545 pounds of acetaldehyde was put into the atmosphere in a year. Not even considering other emission sources or other less popular or generic brands of laundry detergent. We focus a lot of attention on how to reduce emissions of pollutants from automobiles, and here's one source of pollutants that could be reduced. Environmental justice, much like reproductive justice, includes a social justice framework to end the disenfranchisement and environmental racism experienced by people of color, First Nations or Indigenous communities, women, and those living in economically disadvantaged or developing areas. Instead of starting at the micro level to introduce environmental stewardship of trees and endangered species of the world, start micro. To build a habit and familiarity with the everyday choices all folks can make and consider that directly impacts the health and well-being of themselves and loved ones. Start somewhere small and practical, like personal care products, food and diet, or household chemicals, to make the basic connections between environmental toxins and our health, and establish a foundation of direct self-awareness and ownership of one's informed choices and actions. At New Voices, we work to make sure that marginalized communities are not forced to make reproductive decisions while facing the disproportionate impact of continuous exposures to environmental hazards and exploitations. These conditions are not coincidental, and we work to illustrate the systemic ways that poverty, displacement, violence, and toxic exposures are deliberate incidences on communities. When we talk about the health of our environment, we are speaking of a multi-layered experience, which requires us to ask different questions that lead to new, practical, and equitable solutions for our communities. Children are significantly more vulnerable to toxins than adults. They are still developing and have not yet built up immunities to fight diseases or other health conditions. Environmental toxins and issues can have a serious impact on kids' development, especially on their brains, and may affect the way that they learn, grow, and act in irreversible ways. Not only do children have the right to play, but they also have the right to play in safe, non-toxic neighborhood spaces, free from pollution and free from violence. As much prevention is key to keeping ourselves, our kids, and our communities safe, healthy, and thriving. Lessen your exposures to cosmetic and environmental toxins in your everyday routine. Many manufacturers do not disclose what's in a product, but when looking at ingredients, the simpler, the plainer, the shorter, the better. Pay special attention to certain claims like natural, green, flavored, scented, because they might not necessarily be true. Read labels, ask questions, and don't be afraid to push back. It is when our basic foundation of environmental awareness and priorities of our own health and well-being are established as healthy habits and lifestyles, not just temporary and unsustainable service actions or biased over technical research projects. We can independently and self-sufficiently develop strategies to address the greater health inequities that intersect with access to and distribution of safe, healthy, and affordable food, land, air, water, and even jobs in our communities. And I'd like to end with this quote. While environmental issues affecting healthy development are a concern for us all, it is vital to center the needs of race and class societies so that justice can trickle up to everyone. Thank you.